community. Thank you all for having Eitan and I here in Fostering Media Connections here. We're very excited to be surrounded by people like Paul and Judy and everybody else who made this possible and who's a part of this. I mean, it's pretty incredible to see on a Monday in Western Massachusetts this many people congregated around the issue of foster care. But to me, that's not really a surprise because we've spent the last 9 months doing only this and looking only at this issue. Because, you know, I started out as a journalist, and at some point I realized that this story of children experiencing foster care, this story of people engaged in the day-to-day effort of fighting that which causes trauma, those bad things, people really engaged in doing good, was the story of the country. So then I had to come up with a plan to kind of cover that, because that wasn't what newspapers typically wanted. I was covering foster care issues, and in 2008, I caught wind of this federal law, the Fostering Connections to Success and Increasing Adoptions Act. And this law does a number of things, which for me, not being a political guy, or not really understanding anything about anything, because you don't, it takes a while to learn things. For me, it was a blueprint for kind of palpable and substantive change. And that was extension of foster care to age 21 in states that it didn't exist. Of course, Massachusetts had had extension of care to age 22 for a while now. It is giving family members funds to take care of their family members. It is strict mandates ensuring that sibling groups are maintained. It's strict mandates ensuring that foster children have educational stability, so as they bounce from home to home, these young people can have at least the harbor of school. So all these different things came together, and I said, well, what is this representative of? And it is representative of what Lauren, you mentioned, which is that kind of substantive, serious change that has left us in a place where the Department of Children and Families, not only in Massachusetts, I mean, Paul is a very interesting, innovative, smart guy, but the thing is he's not that atypical. When I go around the country, I meet a lot of directors who are really engaged in this work, and it became very apparent to me that really the story of foster care was that story of palpable, happening change all across the country. So I had to come up with a plan, understanding that there was this federal law that could do something, and then understanding that, you know, as a journalist, at moments I had created the chance to push forward policy that helped children. You know, I had been mentoring two children, two young men coming up through the system. Through their emancipation, I saw what had gone wrong, I saw what had gone right. I could write stories in a way that could drive policy to the degree that I was happy with for myself. But I realized you've got this federal law, you have this blueprint of change, and it needs to be implemented state by state by state. And to do that, I would have to recruit an army of journalists. So I determined a plan to kind of travel state to state where we recruit this army of journalists to cover the system. And I was talking to Kathleen Strotman at the Congressional Coalition on Adoption Institute, and you know, we were talking about my plan, and she ended up, you know, being the sponsor of this whole thing, and my project is a project of the Congressional Coalition. But she said, you know, so you really want to start a grassroots movement. And I said, well, yeah, I guess that's what I'm trying to do. And so that's the major goal here, is to leverage the media to spark this grassroots movement centered on children and centered on the belief and the total possibility of making foster care better, and building on all that amazing work that the department and Casey Family Services and all the foundations and all the agencies have done, and the whole system has created over all these years. So I went around, and we got funding from foundations, private donors, to travel the country finding those stories and making those stories of change and possibility the true foster care narrative. We started in Washington, and you know, the variety of different stories is pretty incredible, but you had this one program called Supporting Early Connections, and they were focusing on, we met a family south of Seattle. Father had hit mother, they had been separated, children were taken into care, both of them toddlers, one an infant. And they volunteered for a 10-month program in which they had intensive family psychotherapy. And at the end of that program, we're sitting in a house with a family that has been reconstructed by the collaborative effort of therapists, of CPS workers, of judges, of lawyers, of CASAs, all together around this one little family. And I was talking to the man, Mr. Gabrowski, and I said, you know, this is pretty incredible. You need to share your story. And he said, yeah, it's like the pebble that starts the ripple and that starts the wave and all those other things. But then, of course, we got them on a talk show to talk about this to more people, because as Paul says, there's a lot of public to talk to, so we need to find a way to talk to these people, because I think essentially communicating this message to the general public is the most important critical piece we can do to ensuring that we have a movement to help all of you guys do the hard work you are doing. In Northern California, education, Paul talked about education is a big deal. We met a teacher, Mike Jones, who's also a rapper, so it was kind of funny we were saying Mike Jones, who was at Laguna Creek High School, which had the highest number of children experiencing foster care in high school in Sacramento County. And he recognized that, you know, these young people just needed a chance to talk and figure out what services were out for them and what they could do and what their possibilities were. And so about 3 years ago, he started a program. He identified all the foster youth, self-identified. They started going to weekly classes in a school where, like all other schools in this failing educational system in America, the graduation rate was around 50. Over 90% of those kids were on track to graduate after having started this program. One man with the desire to make change happen. And that was the story of foster care in Sacramento. And that was the story we got in the Sacramento Bee. That's a story we put online on our website. That's the thing we communicated to people, was it is possible. It is very possible. Down also in Northern California, but in a place called the Kinship Center, run by a woman named Carol Biddle, who's another, like, everybody sees Judy as you know, kind of, wow, this Judy woman, where did she come from? And she's doing this amazing work, and she's doing amazing work. But Carol Biddle is like a Judy in Salinas. It's kind of nuts. When you have the national perspective, you see that there are a lot of these different stars shining everywhere. And at the Kinship Center, they had a program in which they wanted to prevent young people from entering foster care. So they had taken advantage of county funds to spend on kinship, to give grandparents support services so they could take care of grandchildren. And something like 7,000 kids had gone through their program, and only 6 had entered foster care. So they were completely flipping it on its back. And this was just because, hey, this made sense. They had a county and they had a department that was willing to work with them on this, and they got to do some innovative things. It was in the course of this, and I'm only telling this story because I'm going to come back to it. Is in the course of this, we met a man named Michael Grand, who we have on videotape, that we should use the videotape more often, because it's really good. And he was talking about, in adoption, you have a triad. You have the biological family, the adoptive family, and the child. And he said this is such an antiquated notion of how we take care of children. And he says it's more about a constellation and how every little piece to the puzzle, everybody has a part to play. And, you know, I'm going to come back to that idea of a constellation, but it's an important one, because right here we have a little constellation going, but we need that constellation to get bigger. In Southern California, the Board of Supervisors in the first supervisorial district in this horribly complicated and confusing LA Unified School District had set up a program where they put social workers in schools. Like, that was, you know, a huge sea change. But when they put social workers in schools, the children experiencing foster care who are identified in those schools started graduating at much higher rates than the average. So again, you saw a complete flipping of the paradigm. When you put resources in the right place, everywhere we have gone, we have seen incredible change. In Maryland, it came from within the department. A very visionary leader, Molly McGrath, who had decided to talk to schools about what do we do when a child is removed? How do we find them a home quickly, as quickly as possible, and one that is near that school of origin so they don't get bounced around, as the federal law prescribes? And she called up her counterpart at Baltimore City Public Schools, and they said, let's enter into a memorandum of understanding around access to emergency cards. So all of a sudden, a social worker was calling from the department saying, blue banana on a Monday to get the code so they could actually access the names of those, that children's friends and family on that emergency card. And they're placing children rapidly with people that those children know and love already in a way that keeps them in schools. That's important stuff. And then, you know, as we progressed and we moved across the country, we came here to Massachusetts. And for the first time, we had kind of gone out of the purely urban environment that we're used to, and we started talking to people. And here, you know, the Department of Children and Families, one thing that I had known about prior to coming was the Adolescent Outreach Program. Madeline's here, and two young people, Crystal and Aaron are here, say hello, who have come through the Adolescent Outreach Program. And, you know, this program, which, again, we have the benefit of the national perspective, talking to researchers, this program was selected because it has a better than the other programs looked at. It does better at getting young people into college than other programs because it takes this holistic approach to kind of creating the self that we all need and deserve. So the educational coordinator, the educational advocate program, as Paul mentioned, you have 29 of these advocates in all of the area offices navigating 370 school districts. So you imagine how that cell phone's ringing. You imagine how incredibly difficult it is to navigate schools, and you have this service for the department. We have folks from Orange Public Schools here, and in Orange is working very closely with DCF, and schools are now becoming a hub of innovation to help children not enter foster care in many cases. But so everywhere we've gone, we've seen incredible potential for change, and we've seen incredible things happening to help children. And you know, in the course of this, we shoot a lot of video. Eitan shoots a lot of video, and then you know, we produce some videos. And in this case, we had spent a lot of time at the Treehouse Foundation, Treehouse in East Hampton. And it's not that it is the only program. There's so many other programs here. There's so many other people doing amazing work. It was just where we happened to spend a lot of time and just where some amazing things were happening. So in the course of this talk, I'd like to show you all a video kind of highlighting that work and how it plays into this constellation idea we're gonna talk about a little bit more before I leave you guys. So.